What is Python? So Python is basically an all-purpose general language that works on multiple platforms. So, you know, it can work on your Mac or Windows or Linux, anything there. But here we will be using on Windows itself. And the best thing about it is that it's high level and it is very, very easy to learn. So the learning curve is really, really shallow. And the third point, you know, it says that the more commonly used for machine learning and predictive modeling. Yes, this is definitely, it is one of the things Python is used for, but Python is emerging more of an universal tool. So it's more of an universal language. You can do anything, whatever you want to do using Python. It could be your ETL job, data visualization, or web development using Django framework. So you know, the third point is not entirely true. It's becoming more of an universal tool. And the other thing is that it is open source and it is free to learn. So that is a very big advantage, that you do not have to pay for Python. You can just download it, and there are so many people, so many users are there. So many users are there who are using Python, so that makes it very, very, that makes it very, very attractive. So now, talking about the spectrum ranking, here Python, you can see it is at the third, where just after C and Java. Of course, you know, all your applications are written in Java, so it's not really that bad. Whereas the other language R, that is like at the fifth position for, you know, data science things. So you can see the icons are there. So you can use Python is mostly used for your web development and desktop uses. So the logos are there. So it's becoming really, really popular because of its you know, it's a shallow learning curve, I would say. So why is Python so popular? So, you know, just if you know Java, so just compare between the Java syntax and the Python syntax. So, you know, Python is an object-oriented language. So, you know, there are class and objects are there, but just to write hello world, you do not need to call any class or any methods or anything like that. So you see, just the print out hello world, you know, just see what the syntax between Java and Python. So the minimal setup is another of Python's POC. So that's why, you know, Python is so popular because of its clean and easy syntax. Okay, so also the other thing is that so as I had mentioned, like, it's a clean syntax, as you have seen from the previous slide, and an expansive library. So Python is a very library based or module based language. There are already a lot of libraries are already available. This you can just plug and play, you know, all the functions that are available, and we will be using some of them. I will take you through what are the libraries that we will cover in this class. And then other thing is that it is your open source, free to download, and it has a massive user base. So it has a massive user base, and that's why, you know, if you're stuck with it, having some problem with your code or anything, you can use your Stack Exchange, Stack Overflow, and really get your everything can get solved. Also, you know, Google. So in R's case, it's the Microsoft. They have bought the R, but in Python's case, its main corporate sponsor is like the Google. So which uses this programming language and number of applications, including the TensorFlow. So if you know TensorFlow, it's the newest deep learning library that comes from Google. They recently has open sourced it. So, you know, the deep learning part, this Python really helps. So why Python is so popular? There are a couple of pointers are here. Readability. Python is very, very syntax is very well thought out and very clean It's a high level and low level programming balance of that. So, you know, you can use Python basically in the shell mode or in the interactive mode. So you can write one line and you can run it, but also you can use it multiple lines and the batch. You can do that. Language interoperability. Python is interoperable with 22 other languages. So if you are interested, just let me know. I will provide you how, if you have written some C code or something, you know, how you can bring them in Python, how you can make that bridge, make the connection. So I will tell you, if you have any specific need, just come to me and, you know, I will guide you case by case basis. Documentation system is highly, very well documented. It has, as I mentioned, it is, you know, the libraries are there. Other than that, it's an object. It can be an object. If you are interested to write object-oriented programming in Python, that can be also be done. So you will have class objects, etc. Other than that, you know, you can, if you are doing repetitive stuff, first you can write a function, your own user-defined function. Then you can write a module where, you know, you can assemble a lot of those functions, and then you can create your own module, and you can also use your one of those libraries that Python already has. So it's very, very well documented as well. Hierarchical modular system, of course, you know, the namespaces we will see. When we get into OOP, then you will see how this hierarchy works. The data structures, Python can, data structure can be both change. You can change a data structure or you cannot change the data structure. So what we call is mutable and immutable. So mutable data structure means that the data structure can be changed, immutable that it cannot be changed. So for example, list is the type of data structure. And tuple is the other type of, that is the immutable. So it means that you can change a list, you can add, delete members in a list, but in a tuple you cannot do that. That functionality is not there. Or it could be a mixture of both mutable and immutable. For example, dictionary is means of a key value pair. So it means that, you know, there are the keys are immutable, you cannot change them, but you can change the values associated with the keys. So that makes it mutable. So, you know, you can have the data structures, and we have dedicated classes on that. Available libraries, there are a lot of libraries available. I will take you through which are the specific libraries we will be going through in this class. And then testing framework, if you are coming from the testing background, there is a unit testing framework that is available within Python. However, that will not be our focus. We will not get into the testing. The main focus of this class would be learning the basics of Python, and then, you know, how we can apply it in data science, data analytics, a couple of machine, a very foundation, basic machine learning algorithms that will take you through. Okay. So now, last class I heard that there were people who are thinking of a career switch into the data science profile, you know, data science, or they are trying to make an entry into the data science or analyst thing. So what they do, data science. So, you know, it is not the only, there is not a specific job that we do. I've been in this field for a while now. So most of the things is important are like ETL work. So, you know, before a data scientist can work on the data needs to be ingested. So the data needs to be ingested and the data needs to be bought in. So you need to create the data pipelines. So there are, you know, there are ETL tools are there, extract, transform, and loads are there. So you can create these ETL tools using Python, or you can also use dedicated softwares like that. After this, that there are, when talking about the data science, you know, the typical type of projects that we do could be find out know about the historical data. And what is just happening now, or what has happened in recent past or in the past? So just like, you know, you You might be interested to know what has been the sales, what are the sales figures, how much the sales had been. So you might also would like to know the sales by month, you know, the sales by month, by sales by month, or by year like that, or by category if you are into retail kind of thing. And you know, you might want to find out how has been the sales by from January to December, and if there are any seasonal picks, because there are some seasonal goods are there. They might have, like, you know, in the festival time, their sales might increase. Other times they might not be there. So, you know, these sales, this type of analytics that we'll do are called the descriptive analytics. So it's just, you know, finding out what is happening with the numbers, nothing much more than that. So that is most of our job, is the you know, visualization and descriptive. But then a lot of modeling, if you are into so when the machine learning, and this is called your predictive modeling. So you know, you want to predict something, like if the sales figure January month was so and so, you might want to understand why is it so. Why has been your sales figure like 10,000 in month of January, but you know, in March it dropped to 8,000. So you want to find out the reason why. That's why, you know, you might want to try some algorithms like linear regression or logistic regression for classification problems, or you might want to find out if a loan application needs to be approved or not approved. So, you know, a kind of decision, yes, no, binary kind of decision that you might not need to figure out. In those cases, this is called your prescriptive analytics. And in this prescriptive analytics, you will have your that is the part of your, you will be applying your machine learning algorithms over here. So you know, these are the basic things that our data analysts do. Other than that, there are regular visualization works are also there, and also reporting work is also there.
I'm sure you enjoyed learning from this video. Please like the video, and if you have any doubts regarding this video, please comment us in the comment section, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more such informative videos. Do look out for other related videos in our playlist. For more information, visit our website now. Keep learning with Intellipaat.